In this week's episode, we turn this crusty old Jeep engine into this. And we do it all in less than an hour. We save so much time, we even got chance to clean up some of the accessories that go with it. Let me show you how. The process is called pulse laser cleaning, and it's a game changer. If you work with rusty, painted, or dirty metal, this will change your life. We've estimated that we are going to save months out of the year on our cleanup operations. The model I went with was the Everlast RedSabre 300CP. I knew I wanted a pulse laser cleaner, and I knew I wanted US support for it. I looked into quite a few manufacturers and models, and this is the only one that ticked all the boxes for me. And the fact that it's about the size of a MIG welder is incredible for the power. We hot tanked this engine, and I was really disappointed with the results. There's a lot of problems with hot tanking as a technology. It removes grease just fine, but it doesn't remove any rust. And you have to leave it in there for days, and it requires a lot of manual processing afterwards to get it even to the point where you can paint it. The amount of labor in every engine is huge right now. Now, this engine doesn't really have any grease in it because of the hot tank. And you might be thinking that the laser cleaner is doing particularly well because of that. And actually, it doesn't care. I would say the big difference between doing a degreased block like this and doing one that's just pulled straight out of a vehicle is you have a little bit more smoke when it's burning through the grease. The laser cleaner itself doesn't really struggle with much. It doesn't like mud. I found that out cleaning up an old 350 Chevy block that was really, really greasy and muddy that a customer dropped off, and I was basically practicing with before we shot this video, so I had a vague idea of what I was doing. They're not hard things to learn how to use at all. I mean, in 5 minutes you're up and running, there's not much to it. But big, thick lumps of mud, it just cleans the top of the mud, it doesn't knock it off, so you're best to hit that off with a jet wash or a brush first. It'll go through paint, it goes through powder coat, there is no difference in speed whatsoever. It doesn't care about oil and grease, it goes through those as well. Gaskets, it won't touch at all. It's not interested in paper and doesn't seem to harm it, really. I think you'd have to sit there for quite a while before it messed up a piece of paper. And I think that's why you see those videos of people using pulse laser cleaners to take the ink off a piece of paper without damaging the paper. I mean, it's mind-blowing to see. And it's so strange when you use this technology for the first time that you can stray off the edge and hit a little bit of cardboard that you had there and it doesn't burst into flames. In fact, there's not a mark on it. And you're thinking, well, how am I taking, you know, powder coat off down to bare metal? And this is not just immediately emoliating this piece of cardboard. It's a very, very strange thing. You can see here that I've actually changed the pattern of the laser. I've gone from a sine wave, which was a rectangular shape, to a circular shape. This is the spiral setting. And this particular laser cleaner, the 300CP RedSabre, has 9 presets set in it under files. And when you go through the manual, it can be a little bit overwhelming. I read it from cover to cover because I didn't want to mess anything up. And there's no real table or guide that tells you what to use what settings for. And when you search and you go onto Google, there is nothing. There's plenty of people asking questions, but nobody actually says, okay, if you're doing this job, if you're doing a rusty, dirty engine block, then put it on this type of setting. So I was a little bit overwhelmed right at the start. And then when I was playing with the menus, I realized that there's all these presets. And clearly whoever developed the laser cleaner has gone in and given a really good starting point for every laser shape. And this can do loads and loads of different shapes. Some of them are really useful. Some of them felt a little gimmicky. I mean, very cool to watch, but I'm not sure what the point is. But that might be because I don't strip paint from wood or, you know, delicate things like that. Once you find the presets, it doesn't take much more than about 5 minutes to go through with a couple of scrap pieces and find out what works best on which materials. I've now got a rough idea of what I want to do for each thing, and if I'm cleaning up an aluminum piston, which, boy, is it quick on that, I know that I need to use a setting that has a bit less power in it, because you want to make sure that with delicate things like that and aluminum that you're not hitting it too hard and with too much power. The software for this though is very good. I was really expecting something that was going to be hard to use and hard to navigate, but it's a brilliant screen size and you find all the settings very, very quickly. Like every new piece of equipment, it takes you a few minutes just to, you know, get your eye in and know what you're doing. But I think this has been very well thought out, and it's, you don't feel like you're fighting through any language barriers or there's a very steep learning curve. It's actually incredibly easy to get going with it straight away and start working. This is about the point when I realise we've left a load of gasket material on here and it needs to be scraped off. So I just grabbed a carbide scraper and took those off so I could clean it properly. It's not really been a big issue in the past, this, because we would run a wire brush in a drill over these engines before we painted them, and that would always take the gasket material off. Obviously, with a laser cleaner, you need to do that before you go in so that you can get everything clean properly. This is the control panel. I'm going in here to select a preset, and then I come out, and then I activate the laser again and continue cleaning. It's that quick to just change over. One of the things I didn't realize about the laser cleaners is you have to have an airline connected to them at all times. They use the air to blow the smoke and dust away from your lens. Now, that's important because your lens is your only consumable. It's a little quartz lens, and it was actually one of the reasons I was really drawn to Everlast, because they sell the replacement lenses at a sensible price. They're $20 each at the moment, and some of the other laser cleaners I was looking at were charging hundreds for the lenses. Now, every time you stop for a minute to do something or do a side and change over, it's a good idea to clean the lens, because they only really get messed up if you allow that dust and dirt and debris to stick to the quartz, and then of course the laser cooks it into the lens. And you don't have to do anything fancy to clean them. You need just need a clean lens cloth and isopropyl alcohol. The pure stuff is absolutely fine. Now you've seen for yourself how fast that is just to get this back to bare metal. There'll be a couple of little places that we'll go over and just touch up, but to get it that clean in that amount of time with no grease whatsoever is just incredible. This is Lexi's first time properly using the machine, and it does show how easy it is to pick up. There's a couple of little things that are worth remembering. You have to kind of think of the gun a bit like you're using a hose pipe. You'd never want to be completely straight onto the object that you're cleaning, because if you hit something that's very reflective, the laser can bounce back up into the gun and damage it. So you always want the gun itself vertically at a slight angle. Now when you're using something that's a rectangle like this, you don't want to tilt it from side to side much, because it will change the distance. If you're using a circular pattern, it makes no difference at all. But you do want to be, as you can see here, just tilted back slightly. And if you think about it like a water jet and imagine where the water would go if you were jet washing that head, just make it so you never splash yourself. Keep it always at that angle and you don't really have a problem. When you first start the laser cleaner up, you press the button once and there's two dots that appear. You can just see them here above the cleaning laser. Now, those two dots, you move the gun backwards and forwards until the two dots become one dot, and that's how you know you're at exactly the right distance. Then you double click the trigger on the gun and it just starts cleaning. Eye safety is critical with these though. I naively thought that I could use some of my fancy welding helmets, and no, not so much. It's a completely different frequency. Now, thankfully, Everlast give you a set of the proper safety goggles with the laser cleaner when you buy it. But if you want to buy spares, or you want to get a full face mask instead of goggles, or something that maybe fits over glasses better, which is something I wanted to do, you have to be very careful when you research which ones to buy. This particular laser cleaner is the 300 watt pulse model, and it's the most powerful they do at the moment. And this needs a 1064 nm wavelength rated safety glasses. And it has to be rated for 300 watts pulse laser. And it has to have an OD6 rating or above for that wavelength. So you can't just go and buy some generic ones off Amazon and hope for the best. You need to check those specs, because this uses a class 4 laser, and that is about as powerful as it gets. You can really mess yourself up and others. Don't let anyone in the shop look at that laser while it's running. Everybody has to be aware of what you're doing, and nobody's going to come in while you're doing it and just stare straight at that thing, because it will mess them up. It is a really big deal. The other thing you need to do is make sure you're wearing a good quality mask. All this rust and grease and dirt has to go somewhere. Yes, it is vaporized, but that's kind of the point. It just puts it into the atmosphere and you can breathe that in. And one of the things we realized really early on, that dust extraction and fume extraction are going to be a big deal for this. We're going to buy some proper ventilation to go for the shop so that we can run this and have everything just venting outside. Because sometimes, especially when you're taking off the really thick, greasy stuff, you can get a lot of smoke. And it can't be good for you. I mean, it's got to be pretty nasty. And if you think, if you're working with vintage stuff, how much of this stuff could have lead in the paint? Or asbestos or other hazardous chemicals? So make sure you're wearing a really good quality mask and you're not taking any chances with your health. It's a very clean process compared to almost anything else. But, like I say, that stuff does have to go somewhere. Small parts like this, we would have typically media blasted in the past. Not so much cylinder heads, because we don't like getting the media inside the water jackets. They would have to be mechanically cleaned. But the other stuff would all be media blasted, and depending on what it is, would depend on what media we use for it. The thing that I found most surprising about this, I mean, you can see how clean they're coming up, is I think we can actually take this stuff straight from here into powder coating. There is no need at all to do any kind of media blasting. For us, that's pretty huge, because we could spend 2 days out of every 5 media blasting parts. Cleanup for us, cleanup and painting, ceramic coating, powder coating is the lion's share of what we do. It takes more time than the actual engine building. And this tool allows us to save so much of that time. You can see how shiny that valve cover is, and that's absolutely perfect for powder coat. It's properly prepared and there's no grease on there, and we would get a really strong bond. When people have problems with powder coat, if assuming that they're using a good quality powder, the biggest thing that they mess up with is not preparing the surface properly. When you see those cheap trailers where the powder coat flakes off after 2 or 3 years, it is just because they tried to coat straight over mill scale and they didn't do any prep whatsoever. Whereas this thing is astonishing. It just takes it down to perfect without any real work. So that's a huge time saver for our shop. I will put a link in the comments to this model of laser cleaner so you can check it out, or if you want any more technical information. I'm not going to pretend these things are cheap. They're not. They're eye-wateringly expensive. And I don't know how realistic they are for home shops, just because they are quite expensive. But for any commercial operation where you're paying labor for stuff to be cleaned, this thing pays for itself very, very quickly. I mean, it's just astonishing how well this comes out with very, very little time spent.